1996 was perhaps the worst year in Marvel Comics' long history as a company. But 1996 would also herald the start of what would ultimately become one of the biggest reversals of fortune in corporate history. A few years earlier, things had been going great. 1991 saw earnings of $115 million. 1992 would see a net income of $224 million. And in 1993, the company would rake in $415 million. These were good times for everyone involved. With so much money to throw around, shareholders would ask themselves, what could go wrong? But soon enough, they'd find out. The profits were due to a speculative bubble, fueled by market sentiment and momentum more than any rock-solid underlying fundamentals. Collectors were buying up multiple copies of comic books in the hopes that one day they'd be collector's items. Prices would then spike as investors jumped in to avoid missing the boat, believing that prices would continue to rise and that an opportunity would be lost if they didn't invest. Eventually, reality caught up with the momentum. The bubble popped, the stock sank, and prices dropped back to pre-bubble levels. Sales dropped by 70%. The company's stock plummeted at an alarming rate. And in December 1996, the good times were officially over. Marvel filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy, and the threat of disappearing forever was a very real possibility. It was no secret that Marvel had a stable of literally thousands and thousands of characters, and it was now time to utilize these superheroes in order to save themselves. Through licensing, Marvel would be able to outsource the expenses to the licensees while keeping a low-cost revenue stream for itself. T-shirts, cartoons, and toys would only generate a relatively small share of the profits, but the bigger prize was for Marvel to license their assets to film and television. Black Panther would go to Columbia with Wesley Snipes attached. Universal had acquired The Incredible Hulk. New Line Cinema had previously purchased the rights to Iron Man, Blade, and the anti-heroic Venom. Oliver Stone was developing Elektra Assassin. Marvel had sold the film rights to the X-Men series to 20th Century Fox in 1994, and it had optioned Spider-Man for film back in 1985. And in 1995, Fox would acquire the rights to Daredevil. If all went well, the late 90s were going to be a spectacular explosion of superhero cinema. The June 1995 issue of Premiere Magazine would announce that director Chris Columbus was on board to write the script. The character of Matt Murdock, Daredevil, had first debuted in Daredevil Issue 1, released on the 4th of February, 1964. Written by Stan Lee, with art by Bill Everett, and contributions to the design by Jack Kirby. As a child, Murdock was raised by a professional boxer and trained to fight. He saves a blind man from the path of an oncoming truck, and is blinded himself as the truck contains a radioactive chemical which spills out during the accident. The boy's exposure to the radioactive substance heightens his remaining senses to superhuman levels. Murdock is left an orphan when his father is murdered after refusing to throw a boxing match, and so Murdock grows up to become Daredevil. Inspired by his father, he works as a lawyer and enacts justice in the courtroom by day, and by night, he's a vigilante. The Devil of Hell's Kitchen would embrace his duality, hone his senses, and excel in taking down gangsters, criminals, and the New York street villains who wish to prey upon the weak and make victims of society. The esteemed artist and writer Frank Miller would later reinvent the character. Miller had initially worked on the book in 1979 for what would be a four-year run. When asked in 81 of comparisons with DC Comics' Batman, Miller would say, "Batman's focus is on the criminal, Daredevil's is on the victim." It was in 1993's reimagining of Daredevil's origin story, in Frank Miller's acclaimed title, Daredevil, The Man Without Fear, a story that would take the character to the next level, and today is not only preceded by its own reputation, but actually lives up to and exceeds it. And Miller was now one of the most sought-after talents in the industry. With art by John Romita Jr., it's not only one of the greatest Daredevil stories ever written, it's one of the greatest and most influential comic books ever written. It was The Man Without Fear that would catch the attention of Hollywood. And when it came time for 20th Century Fox to option which Marvel characters they wanted to develop, Daredevil was immediately fast-tracked. Largely down to the fact that contractual stipulations enforced by Marvel dictated that all rights would revert back to them if the picture wasn't in active development by a given date. In 1994, Chris Columbus had already signed a 3-year deal with 20th Century Fox that would lead to the creation of his company, 1492 Pictures. Columbus back then was a heavy hitter, after hits like the Home Alone movies and Mrs. Doubtfire had placed him in a category as one of the highest-grossing directors of all time. Columbus would work alongside Michael Barnathan, with whom he'd just produced the festive Schwarzenegger comedy, Jingle All the Way. Columbus would later say that the thing that got him into movies in the first place was Marvel Comics, particularly Daredevil. He said they taught him about character development, because the superheroes had flaws, which was something unseen prior to Stan Lee. Fox and Columbus then made a deal to do yet another Marvel movie, The Fantastic Four. Columbus would then begin working with the Italian director Carlo Carle, with the intention of now producing with Carle directing. The filmmaker had made Flight of the Innocent and adapted the James Herbert novel Fluke about a man reincarnated into a dog, both for MGM. Carle was one of the few new Italian directors to have found a space within the American film industry and would interview Michael Mann for the Directors on Directors documentary. Columbus and Carle would each write individual drafts. Several drafts were said to have been written and rewritten across 1995 and in 1996. The two then combined their efforts in order to distill each of their ideas into one. This version of the script, dated September 1996, carries quite an expansive plot that would have clocked in at over 2 hours of screen time. And so, to summarize the story, we open with Matt Murdock's childhood. He hangs around with some no-good friends, indulges in pranks and petty thefts just to fit in. His father, Jack, is a once-great boxer, now competing in wrestling events. The city is one of grief, injustice, tragedy, and hopelessness, and Jack tells his son, "You've got to be somebody special." Mob boss Angelo Policano, aka The Fixer, makes Jack an offer to compete in boxing matches that they oversee. Jack agrees to fight and hopes for a return to the big time. Matt confesses his sins in church as a nun quietly observes him and listens to his prayers. Next day, an out-of-control truck jackknifes along the intersection. It brakes too late to see a blind man standing frozen. Matt dashes toward the man, pushes him out of the way as the skidding trailer smashes into him instead. A container crashes open. A cylinder hits Matt in the eyes. His vision distorts and burns. Matt is taken to the hospital. He's blind, injured. The nun watches him as he rests. Despite the loss of sight, he works out. He trains his body in gymnastics. He's becoming stronger and more powerful. His remaining senses are heightened in new and super powerful ways. Matt's enhanced radar-like ability to detect his environment and to feel and hear. He has an enhanced agility. It all compensates for the loss of sight. His father tells him to keep it secret until he figures it out. We then cut to Matt in his 20s at university. He makes friends with Foggy Nelson. He watches his dad fight on TV at Madison Square Garden. Jack is under orders to take a dive and lose. Jack instead reigns victorious. After the fight, he is taken to a warehouse. He knows what's coming next. The ruthless mobsters show no mercy as he's executed by the cigar-chomping Wilson Fisk, the Fixer, and his mafia goons. Matt's superhearing detects the sounds of the beating from across town. He hears the gunshot. His father's heartbeat trails off. He races through the deserted streets and maze of alleys. He leaps toward the site, but he's too late to prevent his father's death. He cradles his father's body. He can still detect an aroma, which leads him to the mobster's discarded cigar. "I'll find you," he vows. Matt traces down the mob goons at a pool hall. He locates the Fixer's limousine. He chases him down the subway tracks. The Fixer's bullets are useless against Matt. The Fixer clutches his chest and has a heart attack as the police arrive to see Matt standing over the dead body. Matt flees as the cops open fire. We see Wilson Fisk rise to become the criminal kingpin of New York. He takes over territory and drug empires. We intercut as Matt Murdock becomes a lawyer. Newspaper headlines pose the question, "Who is Daredevil?" as Matt Murdock, dressed in a yellow costume that was his father's wrestling character. He takes to the street and rooftops of Hell's Kitchen each night to beat up drug dealers and criminals. We meet killer for hire Juan del Toro, aka Bullseye. He explodes a nightclub with grenades, hurls ninja stars at anyone who gets in his way. We cut to the Manhattan Bridge. Daredevil faces off against Bullseye. Bullseye is faster than anyone Daredevil has previously faced. They fight in unarmed combat, and Bullseye gains the upper hand. He rolls a grenade and explodes the bridge. They fight a spectacular battle atop the suspension cables as the fight is witnessed by the public and the gathering news reporters. Bullseye is taken away in an ambulance as the press discovers the villain is a wanted arsonist. Murdoch represents the victims of the fire in court. It's the people versus Juan del Toro. The TV cameras and news report the superhero vigilante in their midst. Bullseye is released without charge by the judge. Murdoch meets a young woman by the name of Elektra as she's performing gymnastic stunts and physical feats on top of the Twin Towers. The two become romantically involved. Elektra seems to have a mysterious past and a dark side. During a showdown with some knife-wielding street punks, we see she is a highly trained martial artist and combat specialist, much to Murdoch's surprise. Murdoch meets Elektra's father, the Greek consul general, Nick Nachios, at their opulent family mansion. The mansion is ambushed by Bullseye and Kingpin. A gunfight ensues with Nico's bodyguards and Kingpin's henchmen. Daredevil appears. Kingpin puts two and two together, saying Murdoch is your guest, and Daredevil shows up just when you need the cavalry. What a coincidence! Of course, the boxer's son. How could I have been so naive? Kingpin beats Nikos to near death with his bare hands. Bullseye and Kingpin leave in a helicopter. Daredevil gives chase, rushing through the wintry woods, trees looming and swooping past, feet barely touching the ground. He leaps and hangs onto the underbelly of the helicopter as it rises into the night sky. Bullseye opens the door and begins to shoot at Daredevil. They engage in a vicious fight as the helicopter crashes down into an icy lake. Daredevil emerges through the thick layer of ice. A limousine rolls down the hill and goes under the water. Daredevil swims down and rescues the passenger. It's Elektra's father. He detects a faint heartbeat. He's barely alive. Daredevil swims him to the surface of the lake, and Elektra runs toward the scene, screaming for her father. Daredevil removes his mask, reveals his identity to her. "Who is this?" she asks. "Bullseye and Fisk," he tells her. She doesn't believe him. She says Fisk is a close family friend and that he'd previously saved her life. She slaps Matt and sends him away. At Nico's funeral, Matt sees Kingpin with his arm around a grieving Elektra. As they leave in a limo, Kingpin proposes marriage to Elektra. She refuses. He sits angry and humiliated. She feels woozy. "What did you do?" she asks, before passing out cold. Matt, in his role as lawyer, tries to prove that Kingpin is behind the arsons all over New York, that it's a land-buying scam. And if residents refuse to leave, they're burned out of their homes, and Kingpin purchases the land and takes out any rival contractors. Matt digs deeper. Foggy informs him that he's about to be arrested by the DA on false charges of bribery, perjury, jury tampering, and misconduct. Matt is put on trial. Kingpin watches the proceedings on TV. He enjoys the show. Matt asks the judge how much he was paid to sell his soul. He is disbarred, but Foggy manages to keep him out of prison. Matt arrives at Kingpin's high-rise office at Fisk Industries. He enters the penthouse suite. Kingpin greets him and says, "I felt the fury and desperation behind that blind boy running to save his father. I have even asked myself several times where I could have seen that stupid suit before. But I never thought about Jack Murdoch. I never made the connection. I made you, young man. That's why you're here." Matt, with a voice of quiet fury, asks him, "Did you kill my father?" Kingpin replies, "I didn't, for what it's worth. Not that it mightn't have come to that. He was so dumb and tenacious. It took a bullet from the fixer. I myself would have left him a cripple, living testimony to the fruits of betrayal. And you to change his diapers, spoon-feed him meals, push his wheelchair, instead of dedicating your life to avenging his murder." Matt is a blur of emotion. Faster than is possible, he is across the room, and with all his strength, he bludgeons Kingpin in the face with his club. The two get into a titanic battle. Weights and barbells are used as weapons. Both men beat each other up, Kingpin can move faster than Matt ever imagined. He strikes Matt to the floor. Matt whirls the club once more, but in that moment, he feels a jab in his arm. Blood oozes out as a ninja star is buried in his arm. Matt turns. His point of view can sense as a tall, slender silhouette shining against the black background. It's Elektra. Kingpin says, "You remember our mutual friend, Miss Elektra Nachios." Kingpin takes advantage of Matt's astonishment and grabs his hand, wrenching the club from it. It clatters across the room. Matt swings his other fist, but Kingpin grasps it in his giant hand and squeezes. Kingpin rears back and punches Matt. 400-pound punches over and over again. Matt fades and crumples to the floor. Henchmen carry Matt to the underground water drainage system and seal him inside a pipe. As he awakes, the henchmen unload their guns into him. Matt's body floats in the still water as if suspended in a flotation tank. He has a vision of his father. He hears his father's voice. "Remember, Matt, you're my son. You're a fighter. You are the man without fear. No kingpin, no heaven or hell can take that away. Come on, son. Let's get out of here." Matt flies out of the pipe and falls 20 feet down into the Hudson River. He struggles but manages to free himself. He reaches the shore and emerges from the river like a ghost, soaking wet, limping, wounded. He recuperates in a room at the church. The nun from when he was a boy helps nurse him back to health. This is a plot point that readers of Frank Miller's Born Again would have recognized, as the nun introduces herself as Maggie. Matt emerges, fresh, strong, and determined. Matt cuts a section of a thin Kevlar flak jacket with a laser scalpel, and using an airbrush, he sprays the section red. Then he welds some metal plates to the fabric. He hand paints a double D onto the fabric. He puts everything together and walks silently into the night. The nun looks silently at him with a proud smile. The new costume is armored and majestic, and he is finally ready for a comeback. The new daredevil flies through the sky, swinging from building to building. He sees Elektra. He trails her. She turns and punches him, and they get into a fight that leaves Daredevil stabbed, protected only by his new armor as he retreats to safety. We learn that Elektra had been kidnapped by ninjas during her youth and brainwashed. She was trained in ancient disciplines and achieved a mastery of every martial art. She is now the brainwashed servant of Kingpin, Bullseye's replacement, trained to kill on command. Kingpin now harbors ambitions to be elected as the mayor of New York. Elektra's spell is broken, and she begins to remember everything. Kingpin rehires Bullseye, and a bomb is planted to level the entire neighborhood. Bullseye and Elektra do battle. "You helped him kill my father," she says. She reverses his attack and weapons against him, and Bullseye is caught in an explosion as his weapons blaze. Elektra tries to flee the explosion, but the beams break as she is left hanging. Daredevil saves her. She remembers who he is, and they embrace. He takes on Bullseye as explosion after explosion tears through the streets. Bullseye emerges from the twisted inferno. He tries to kill Daredevil, who ducks and dodges every attack. Bullseye slips onto the bomb as it detonates and dies. Kingpin stands at the window, watching the smoke from the Hell's Kitchen fires a few blocks away. His office is darkened and utterly quiet. He picks up a remote control. Daredevil crashes through the window in a rain of broken glass. Kingpin presses the remote. Suddenly, marching music blasts from every direction. The aquarium glass shatters and fish and water gush out. Kingpin circles Daredevil, manipulating the remote, adding layers of sound, whistles, bells, gunshots. He says, "Do you like my sound system? I had it custom made with you in mind. A good investment, no?" Then Kingpin places a set of goggles around his eyes and pushes another button. Light projectors come down from the ceiling. Each one inundates the room with a different color. Reds, whites, greens, yellows, blues. Every tone and subtone of the spectrum is projected into the room like a rainbow. Daredevil stands still, completely disoriented, as through his eyes he sees violent waves of different shades of black swirling crazily all around, confusing his radar sense and completely blacking out his perception. Now, Daredevil is really blind. Kingpin holds a gun. Locke's a perfect target on Daredevil, who can detect his heartbeat. Daredevil blurs his movement as he dodges the bullets. Windows are shattered, and Kingpin falls to his death onto the streets below. As time passes, the streets begin to heal again. Later, Matt returns to the church. He sees Maggie. "Tell me, please," he says. "Are you my mother?" She says no. Matt hears the rhythm of her heartbeat skip. Matt says, "It's a sin to tell a lie in the house of God. Dad used to say that." She nods and says, "I know." They embrace, and then she turns and leaves and disappears into the darkness. The end. Once this draft was completed, it was no doubt easy to see that it was in need of some script doctoring. The fact it was two separate scripts combined into one could be the reason for why certain subplots would go nowhere and remain unresolved, while details that could have been expanded into something richer remain undeveloped. That said, it was a first draft, and along with another rewrite, writer John Mark DeMatteis would receive commission to shape all of the best aspects from each into one coherent treatment. DeMatteis is a comic book writer who for four decades has worked for DC and Marvel on a great many number of famous titles, including Daredevil and notably Marvel's Kraven's Last Hunt story arc, which is without a doubt one of the most respected and reread Spider-Man stories ever written. He has also written for television and DC's animated films and is a true talent. DeMatteis would share his treatment with fans on his blog, where he explained that he had met and become friends with Carlos Carley, who was working on Daredevil. He even arrived home one day to find a message from Stan Lee on his answering machine, saying that he'd read it and absolutely loved it. However, the powers that be at Fox, the executive in charge of the Daredevil project, wasn't as thrilled with the treatment as everyone else was. The rights, which were then due for renewal, were allowed to lapse, and new producers, writers, and directors came along, ultimately bringing Daredevil to the screen in 2003. The 1997 65-page treatment written by DeMatteis would retain much of the structure and plot from the earlier written scripts, but would improve and flesh out the characters of Elektra and Bullseye, adding dimension and texture to what had previously felt a little flat and sometimes illogical. Some elements were excised, which gave the storyline a better pace and resolution. DeMatteis would say, "It's far from perfect, but I think it's a solid blueprint for what could have been an excellent film. I've always enjoyed the character, but didn't really begin to appreciate Daredevil on a deeper level till I briefly wrote the book in the 90s. And then working on this treatment made me really think about the essence, the core of Daredevil in an even deeper way. So it's another case of not fully appreciating a character until I've been asked to write him." With Fox chairman Tom Rothman not overly keen on spending up to $100 million on a story he wasn't 100% in approval of, it seemed as though the option would expire without any serious progression into pre-production. And so now, Marvel could choose to offer the property elsewhere. Back when Columbus had the property in 1995, writer and former film student Mark Steven Johnson was invited to rewrite one of the very early drafts. Johnson had sold his first spec screenplay, Grumpy Old Men, when still an assistant. The film would become one of the surprise hits of 1993, and despite a love of the Daredevil character, Johnson would only offer Columbus a few suggestions before throwing himself into working full-time on the 1995 sequel, Grumpier Old Men. Once the rights became available, Disney would briefly inquire before Sony would circle the title in November. Johnson would go after the rights himself and pitch it all over Hollywood, first selling the project and then selling himself as the potential director. Sony would agree to a Johnson rewrite until they fell out of negotiations with Marvel, and then New Regency stepped in and sealed the deal, with Fox back on board to distribute. This would require Johnson to start the process over and get rehired for the job. The finished movie, starring Ben Affleck as Daredevil, Colin Farrell as Bullseye, Michael Clarke Duncan as Kingpin, and Jennifer Garner as Elektra, would open in February 2003 to mixed reviews and would earn more than double its budget. Plans for a Daredevil 2 were considered, although never fully explored. In October 2004, Affleck gave an interview and stated he would consider going back to Daredevil, just as long as Fox would negotiate to tell some of the darker storylines. He wanted to see a big-screen adaptation of Kevin Smith's Guardian Devil graphic novel that included Mysterio, or maybe even born again, and believe that these storylines might be a bit obscure for 20th Century Fox and may require some negotiations. Although in 2006, the future Batman would say, "By playing a superhero in Daredevil, I have inoculated myself from ever playing another superhero. Wearing a costume was a source of humiliation for me, and something I wouldn't want to do again soon." In February 2010, it was announced that Regency Enterprises were looking to develop a Daredevil reboot, and screenwriter David Scarpa, who scripted the Day the Earth Stood Still remake, was hired to write. 20th Century Fox were signed on to distribute, or the rights reverted back to Marvel, who were by this point owned by Disney. Another year would pass without any word or update on proceedings, and then in March 2011, Variety would break the story that director David Slade, who had recently made 30 Days of Night, has been hired to do the reboot of the Daredevil franchise. Sources were saying that the new storyline would be an adaptation of Born Again, in which Daredevil's drug-addicted girlfriend, Karen Page, sells Matt Murdock's secret identity in exchange for a shot of heroin. The information finds its way to the Kingpin, who begins to systematically destroy his life. The report also stated that the new version would not contain material from the 2003 Daredevil and Ben Affleck. With no further mention of David Scarpa's script, Fox hired the writer of Brooklyn's Finest, Brad Caleb Kane. Slade would confirm Kane's involvement on Twitter, and the writer would later add, "We'll do our best to do right by him and the fans." Director Slade would say, "Born Again is our main source material with all its grittiness." He would also say that, "We are at the early planning stages and have not yet discussed any cast. It's a very strong character-driven take on Mr. Matt Murdock. It will bear no relation to the previous Daredevil movie in any way." There were initial rumors that Slade would be looking to cast his Twilight star Robert Pattinson, although the rumor seemingly had yet to reach Pattinson, who when told of the reboot by MTV would reply, "That Ben Affleck movie? That's weird. Didn't that only come out about 3 years ago?" Any news on the project was scant until Fox hired David James Kelly to rewrite the script. As Kelly began the rewrite, Fox threw their energies into Josh Trank's Fantastic Four, and the Daredevil rights were literally now only a few months away from returning back to Marvel. Slade then dropped out of the project to help shape the NBC drama Hannibal. He would say, "I saw it as really complex and exciting. I was really, really excited about it." He would hint that Fox had complicated matters somewhat, and of his vision he would say, "It's in the 70s. Kingpin is going through New York dealing with the Irish Mafia, and there's Daredevil in the yellow suit. It was all there. You know, it's a big studio film, and it's tougher. There are certain people who are really good at that, and I hope to be really good at that. I will continue to try my best." In August 2012, Fox would enter discussions with the A-Team director Joe Carnahan to pitch his take on what was being described as a Frank Miller-esque hardcore 70s thriller aesthetic. Carnahan hadn't received an official offer, though multiple sources told Variety that he was the studio's first choice. The problem was that Fox needed to start principal photography by October 10th, or Marvel got the Daredevil character back. Fox is said to be impressed with Carnahan's take, but meeting the 45-day deadline was nearly impossible. Carnahan would later release his visual pitch, a splice reel he had edited together, and would say, "What people don't realize about the Daredevil project is that the producers of the film got to me very late. They had a script that I read, and I thought that while the action was wonderful, the story didn't really have any additional bite. There was nothing. I suggested a trilogy as follows: Daredevil 73, Daredevil 79, and Daredevil 85, where I was going to do a kind of cultural libretto and make the music of those eras a kind of thematic arc. So the first one would be classic rock, the second one would be punk rock, and the third film would be new wave. The problem was, the option was almost set to lapse, so we made an 11th hour bid to Marvel to retain the rights for a bit longer so I could rework the script. Unfortunately, it just didn't happen. Marvel wanted the rights back. I don't blame them." As soon as they got the rights back from Fox, Marvel Studios began work on a new Daredevil TV series. Drew Goddard was hired as showrunner, but not before he had pitched unsuccessfully to Marvel to make a feature film Daredevil instead. He would later say, I went into Marvel and talked to them about making it as a movie a couple of years ago, long after the Affleck movie. But what we all sort of realized is that this movie doesn't want to cost $200 million. The thing about Matt Murdock is, he's not saving the world, he's just keeping his corner clean. So it would feel wrong to have spaceships crashing in the middle of the city. But because of that, Marvel on the movie side is not in the business of making $25 million movies. They're going big, as they should. Marvel's Daredevil TV series would then run for 3 seasons, from 2015 to 2018, with actor Charlie Cox in the title role. The successful and widely acclaimed show was sadly canceled in a move that would disappoint fans, the cast, and the creatives behind the camera. And that completes our timeline of Daredevil movies that never were. There's talk that the TV series could be picked up by Hulu, and there's the occasional rumor that Cox's Daredevil may appear in Spider-Man 3. I don't know. I guess time will tell. But for now, thanks for watching.